In this video, I'll describe the structure and properties of lipid bilayers. Recall from the previous video that glycerol phospholipids and sphingomyelins are amphipathic. They have a hydrophilic head group and hydrophobic tail groups. When placed in water, such molecules spontaneously assemble into bilayers to prevent the hydrophobic parts from coming into contact with the polar water molecules. The hydrophilic head groups are on the outside of the bilayer, making favorable contacts with water, while the hydrophobic tail groups are in the middle, protected from water. Now, if the bilayer stayed as a flat sheet, the hydrophobic groups would be exposed to water on the edges. To prevent that, the bilayer curves around to form a sphere, enclosing water inside it. This type of structure is the basis for biological membranes. Lipid bilayers are said to be fluid because individual lipid molecules are not fixed in position, but can move and diffuse within the bilayer. For example, lipids can move laterally from one place to another in the plane of the bilayer. They can rotate or spin around an axis perpendicular to the bilayer. Rotation around carbon-carbon bonds in the hydrophobic tails causes bending or flexing of the tails. The greater the movement of lipids in the bilayer, the more fluid the bilayer is said to be. Several factors influence the diffusion rate of lipids in a bilayer. First, the higher the temperature, the faster the diffusion. Second, as the length of the hydrocarbon tails increases, the rate of diffusion decreases. This is because the tails attract each other through induced dipoles, and so they experience something like friction as they slide past each other. The more carbons, the more friction, and the slower the diffusion. Third, as the number of double bonds in the hydrocarbon tails increases, the rate of diffusion also increases. Remember that double bonds cause kinks in the hydrocarbon chains, so the chains that have double bonds can't pack as efficiently together and will experience less friction as they slide past each other. And fourth, the concentration of cholesterol in the membrane also affects membrane fluidity. Now, cholesterol's impact on fluidity depends on the temperature. To see why, let's look more closely at how cholesterol fits into the bilayer. Cholesterol is represented here by this green shape. Remember that cholesterol is a steroid with four interconnected rings plus some other carbon atoms. The molecule is largely hydrophobic except for a single polar hydroxyl group on one end. Cholesterol is smaller than the glycerol phospholipid and sphingolipid molecules in the bilayer, which is shown in the two diagrams on the right. When the temperature is high and the lipid molecules tend to diffuse quickly in the bilayer, cholesterol gets in the way and impedes lipid diffusion. It's an additional source of friction that slows the other lipids down. The result is that at high temperatures, adding cholesterol to a bilayer reduces the fluidity of that bilayer. However, when the temperature is low, the lipid molecules slow down. If the temperature is low enough, they start packing together, sort of like freezing the bilayer. Again, cholesterol gets in the way, but now it prevents the other lipid molecules from packing together efficiently. The result is that at low temperatures, adding cholesterol to a bilayer increases the fluidity of the bilayer. You're not responsible in this course for knowing exact temperatures at which cholesterol will have its different effects. It's enough to know that at high temperatures, cholesterol reduces the fluidity, and at low temperatures, cholesterol increases the fluidity. Organisms try to maintain their bilayers at an optimal level of fluidity. Therefore, they will adjust the cholesterol concentration as well as the length of hydrocarbon chains and degree of unsaturation as appropriate. A final point is that biological membranes are asymmetrical. That means that the composition of the outer layer of the membrane is different from the composition of the inner layer. This is true in terms of the polar head groups on lipids and in terms of the orientation of proteins embedded in the bilayer. I'll talk more about membrane proteins in the next video. For example, some membrane lipids have carbohydrate or sugar groups as part of their polar heads, represented by these yellow shapes. Carbohydrate groups will never be found on the side of the membrane facing the cytosol, but always on the other side. It's relatively easy to maintain asymmetry of lipids in a membrane because diffusion of a lipid molecule from one side of the membrane to the other is very slow. This is an unfavorable process because the polar head group would have to be exposed to the inside, the hydrophobic interior of the membrane as it crosses. But given enough time, some lipids will cross from one side to the other like this, so cells have enzymes that move stray lipids back to the correct side. This maintains the asymmetry of the membrane. An exception to the asymmetry of the membrane is cholesterol, which cannot be maintained on one side of the membrane or the other. This is because its polar head group is so small. Having gone over these properties of lipid bilayers, we can move on in the next video to consider how proteins interact with biological membranes.